This is Henk Akkermans and this is Smart Asset Management Lecture 3, Section 3.2, Financial Complexity of Life Cycle Costing, some financial accounting basics. We already saw that that financial complexity, technical complexity and operational complexity interact. Perhaps the financial complexity, although it can look pretty intimidating, is the least worrisome. So let's start with that one. Let's have a simple example. We have two machines here. We have machine A and machine B. They both do the same thing. They both have a guaranteed lifetime of 3 years, which is in working days some 660 days. They almost have the same guaranteed availability during that period of 99% or even more, 99.5%. Big difference, B is a lot cheaper than A, so this seems to be an easy decision. Let's choose B because that's the cheaper purchase price, and in fact, that's what many people would do. However, if you look more at the life cycle costs and also look at the initial cost of teaching the operators to use the machine, apparently machine B is slightly more complicated to handle and therefore costs a bit more to train the people. So you have to take the extra cost into account, and then the investment cost becomes somewhat less. If you also look at the cost of the repairs over those 3 years, and yeah, both of them have a very low breakdown, only 1% not available versus 0.5% available, but half is half of one. So the repair costs are of machine A are half of that machine B. And now we have a situation in which the life cycle costs of both machine A and B are the same, so it doesn't matter anymore. Well, it does, because we're not quite there yet. We also have to look at the residual value, the value at the end of the 3 years, the salvage value. And here you see that machine B, the cheaper one, has less of residual value than machine A, the newer one. So all of a sudden, after 3 years, you can sell a machine A for more than you can sell machine B. So now it becomes a better idea to sell machine A. In the context of maintenance, let's look at perhaps the biggest impact, which is the impact of that non-availability on production. So the days needed for repair of those 660 days, that's 3.3 days for machine A or 6.6 days for machine B. If we then assume that the cost of the employee not being able to use the machine is something like 227 euros a day. So the fact that these people are idle, and the cost of the machine not being available, so you cannot do production with it, is even higher, then all of a sudden it's quite clear that the life cycle cost of machine A is much lower than that of machine B. And that's all in those small numbers. So that's the idea of life cycle costing, that the initial value, the initial purchase price, doesn't say everything about the total life cycle cost. And that small difference in the quality of the asset, its uptime, etc., have a big impact at the end of the and at the bottom line. So there is the non-recurring and the recurring cost. The non-recurring costs are the costs you make initially. The procurement, the installation, the qualification, some R&D, some training. That's the cost you'd make one time. Then there are the recurring costs, the costs that you make every period, every year or so. The operating costs, the inventory, the support costs, the manpower. This is what we typically call CapEx, capital expenditures. This is what we typically call OPEX. And the total cost then is all of these combined. Now, yes, but we didn't take into account the time value of money, which is a very important notion in finance and in engineering economics. A euro now is worth more than the same euro in the future. Why is that? Well, if I have to choose between giving you 100 euro now or promising that I will give you 100 euro in 10 years, I'll always do the promise for 10 years because I can now start using that 100 euro to do other things with it. In a far distant path, you could get some decent interest rate on it from savings in a bank, but you can still invest it. And so you can do other things with that 100 euro in the meantime. And that becomes then the fundamental guideline in economic and financial decisions. And there's even the whole series of mathematics around it, the time value of money mathematics, which basically is you have some cash flows in the future, and let's translate it into money now, or you have some money now, and let's translate it into what will be the value in the future. The present value versus the future value, and in discounted cash flow analysis, you evaluate these investments by estimating what will happen, taking into account the time value of money. All these very wise observations, by the way, are, as I indicated earlier on, made by my distinguished colleague Willem van Groenendaal, and these are mostly his slides. The present value and the future value of a single sum. There is some compounding happening. Suppose that there is 100 euros in the future. What does that mean then for its value today? Well, it depends on how far in the future, that's n in this case, the number of periods, and depends on the interest rate that we take, the annual, in this case, an annual and compounded interest rate. If you then take what's the present value today of that 100 euros in the future, is the 100 euros divided by the interest rate compounded over the number of years. So we can either say, well, 100 euros today in 3 years' time is worth 86.38 euros today, or 86.38 euros today is worth 100 euros in 3 years' time. If we then look at life cycle costing, that is the net present value of all the main cost elements. So there are the capital expenditures, the initial investments in the project, the engineering, the contractor, all the purchasing costs, all those initial costs, the installation, the transportation, the initial training. And then there is the OPEX. Operation man-hour, maintenance per schedule, subcontractor, all the recurring cost over the life cycle. You can take out of that the cost in revenue, what happens when there's loss of revenue because it's either planned or unscheduled, as we saw earlier on, the unavailability, some penalties. And of course, depending on whether or not the value at the end of the lifetime is positive or negative, the decommissioning costs or benefits. And as you see around here, that's all discounted over time. Now, from this basic notion, financial economics has different ways, and companies in practice have different ways of playing with these mathematics. There's the net present value, there's the internal rate of return, there's the payback period, and there's break-even analysis. And all of them sort of use the same formula, but in a different way. And this is not a full lecture on those financial economics, or engineering economics, but still very briefly, in the net present value, you simply calculate, well, what is indeed the net present value of an investment project. If you take the investment today, the recurring cost over the day today, then the revenue impact, and then the decommissioning, is this the net present value? Is that positive? Is if it's negative, then actually it means that over time, yeah, it only costs you money. So you can then choose the net present value with the highest revenue, or the highest net present value, or the smallest life cycle costing. Small snag though, the I then becomes very important. What is the interest rate against which you evaluate this? The internal rate of return, uses the other approach. It now says, now I want a net present value of zero. What then becomes that I? What then is the internal rate of return? And if you then have a net present value at zero, if the internal rate of return of option A is 5% internal rate of return and option B is 20%, then apparently the 20%, you make a lot more money. It's much more attractive because even if you discount this over time against 20%, still the net present value becomes zero. And because you again take the CapEx and the OpEx and the revenue impact and the decommissioning cost here, these calculations can become more complicated. It can indeed become a much more complex mathematical equation. Especially, for instance, the outflow at the end of the project is really high because you have these large decommissioning costs. What companies now do in practice, they say that the internal rate of return has to be a minimum number if we actually want this to happen, if we think it's a good investment. And that's what companies then call the minimum attractive rate of return. It's usually set at a certain percentage. And what percentage? Yeah, that's a choice. A commonly occurring term in practice, the weighted average cost of capital. Here you look specifically at, because there's also the thing of if it's your own money or if it's borrowed money, what then is the desired revenue, the return that you want on the capital that you invest. And that may lead you to what's then the minimum attractive rate of return based on that WACC. These are choices, and this is the secret language spoken by financial analysts, which, as you see, is based on pretty straightforward mathematics and different ways of playing with the mathematics. The bottom line remains that in a life cycle costing, you take both the initial cost, the cost over time, and the revenue impact, and the cost at the end of the life cycle, and you discount that over time. And what you then do, what do you look at? Is this a positive number, or at what rate of discounting is it still neutral? Well, that's pretty much up to you. Because the higher you make that internal rate of return, the higher the targeted risk, the more likely it is that the net present value becomes zero. If you say, well, I'm already happy with the discount rate of 2%, then it may well be that you have a very, that the net present value is quite positive. If you say, no, I want it at 12%, then sooner, then that's a really, well, that's a steep goal that you then aim for. And it may be that then the value the project becomes unattractive, not because it isn't attractive, but because the target for us is too attractive. What we do is too high. What we don't do here in this analysis is, and what I see most often in practice, is simply the payback period. In how many years will the initial investment be set off against the expected savings or the expecting revenue increases in time? And often those are not even set against all sort of discounting rates. But if you want to do it a bit fancy, then this is how you do it. But again, the discount, but the payback period, of course, if you have the initial costs, you have the end of life cost, and then you have the annual cost. Well, is this investment, the initial cost, already compensated in 1, 2, or 10 years by the initial cost? And that's often the easiest way to talk about it, either by discussing whether or not you should put solar panels on your house. Do you get a payback after 5 or after 10 years? Or a more complex decision, should we invest in these new technologies if we get a payback after 5 or after 10 years? But if you want to do it fancy, then use the net present value or the internal rate of return. Important to note here that in these calculations, the risks, etc., are either disregarded or when they are included, they are not assumed to be interdependent or endogenous. They are assumed to come from the outside. And of course, if you can ensure those risks, but the notion that we have in this lecture is that many of these risks are interdependent and they are driven by other contingencies. That's where it gets more complicated than just on the financial mathematics side, and that's where we'll continue in the next lectures.